only begotten Son. Father, we're taken back by the idea that you made us in your image after your likeness. And so from the very least a human being, Lord God, maybe that has been born out of the challenges of the fall of Adam, and maybe they're locked up in somewhere, or maybe they're unable to function normally, how that you love them most. It says, even those which we think are least, you give and bestow more great and abundant honor. And so, Lord, you love us so much, I think it's beyond our understanding. It says love that passes knowledge. And so we want to invite you in to sit with us as we study your word. And I ask that the Holy Spirit would reveal little nuggets of truth that each individual believer might practice, and those that hear me later on through the sound of my voice on a CD, Lord God, will be able to pick up what you want to share to the church and in this hour, because this is a lot of rain, Father. The former rain has prepared our hearts, birthed the church. But now in this latter rain, great harvests are coming. People are getting saved all over the world. Even Islam people that have been duped, Lord, you're saving them. They're seeing visions of Christ. And so we'll continue to pray, Father, continue to walk with you. And we are looking for your eternal coming. And we're excited. So we trim our lamps and we keep our anointing oil full. We keep the anointing in our hearts full and our hearts open to you, Father. And help us in every area that we fall short. In Jesus' name. And everybody that agreed said, all right, we've been doing In Christ Revelations. This will come out to be something you can take home and teach a Bible study for an entire year, giving 2 weeks off. But at the same time, I want to teach you about the mantle of the Lord. The Word of God contains all of life's mysteries, but they are unlocked and unveiled only to us by His Spirit. Remember what God said to Peter? Peter, flesh and blood did not reveal the truth that I'm the Christ to you. I'm kind of paraphrasing. But my Father, which is in heaven, the truth that you and I are to know is the truth God wants us to know in His Word. But He's hidden those things in the Word of God so that those that are searching for treasure might find them. Because the Bible says, where our treasure is, there is our heart also. And so I was talking to a brother the other day, and I said, let me encourage you to go to God and have Him put a hunger in your heart to search the Scripture. Somehow today, it seems like the church has gotten away from Scripture. They pick up a little Scripture on their iPad, or they do something here, and I'm not putting any of that down. Please don't take the negative part of it. But you know what? When's the last time we just opened our Bible and let God speak richly to us? And so today, we're going to see some things in the Word of God that are right there for our understanding, that He wants to richly bless you. But it's no good, folks, if we don't pick up the Word and practice it. The Bible says if we just hear the Word and don't practice it, we'll bring deception to ourselves, because we'll get all self-conscious, you know. You know, golly, sister, God's been using me mightily. What's He been doing with you, huh? You see how we come across? It isn't about us. It's about our walk with Jesus and about Jesus being absolutely in control of our lives. And that takes a daily surrender. Can you say amen? Besides all these good things, and hidden within Scripture is the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. Who is He talking to? He's talking to you and I. You and I are born again. So God has granted us the spirit of wisdom. May He give us the revelation in the knowledge of Him. And may you and I remember God does not want us to be ignorant concerning our spiritual lives. Oh, yes, we're sort of trained as moms. We're trained as moms, you know, and if you're not, you'll learn. Amen. And dads, you know, we get all that physical training. But the Holy Spirit is here to train us in spiritual matters. Because first and foremost, God designed for us to walk with Him in the beginning. Did He not? He came and He walked with Adam and Eve in the cool of the day. Well, He wants us to return to Him and to walk with Him. Now, I don't know about you, but I just keep falling in love with Him over and over and over and over again. How many here keep falling in love with Him? I just get up in the morning and His sweet spirit comes on. And it just begins to touch me. And of course, I get weepy and he's exercising my spirit. And last week we told you that your spirit is kind of like a wine bag that needs to be rubbed down with oil and filled with the newness of God's spirit so it can stretch and move and God can have his way in our lives and reach through us and touch the lives of others. So this is one of these messages that I want to give you. The mantle of the Lord, understanding what it is, how it operates. Amen. So today, church, God wants us to learn on the mantle of this Lord. So go with me to 1 Kings. We're going to go some Old Testament with you. We're going to look at the two individuals, the two prophets that really were like Christ. And so there's a lot of types and shadows here. 1 Kings 19, we're going to pick up at 19 through verse 21. Elisha, the servant of Elijah. Amen. But there's some truths in here. Now, I always want to encourage the body of Christ that when you are reading Old Testament, read it in the light of Jesus Christ so that you can get all of the nuggets out of there. And, of course, if you've been to Bible college, I don't know if you have or not, but the Bible says that the Old Testament is the New Testament concealed and the New Testament is the Old Testament revealed. So the things that were hidden in the Old Testament, the things that sometimes the law could not produce, God did by sending his son. And us walking with him and fellowshipping with him, he allows us to understand the mysteries of spiritual life or the kingdom of heaven. 1 Kings 19, and I'm going to read this rather quickly, just giving you some points, because the real blessing of it is later on. So I don't want to keep here all day. So it's talking about Elijah. He just got through being depressed. Now, we see all these wonderful men and women in Hebrews chapter 11. It talks about through faith, Moses, and through faith, Elijah, and through faith, and through faith. But they were all just human beings. Look at David. Not only did he commit adultery, but he murdered somebody. And yet God calls him a man after his own heart. Now, I'm not justifying wrong, but I just want to let you know God is not so willing to let you go as we think he is. He doesn't want to let any of us go. He wants to work with us. He wants us to be able to find our solace in him and to find our strength in him. But it has to be an exchange of you and I doing that and opening our heart and allow God to be God in our heart. So here we go. He was hiding in the cave and God showed fire. He showed wind and it was an earthquake, you know, and Elijah. Then finally, a still small voice said to him, "Here I am. What are you doing here, Elijah?" He said, "You don't understand. Everybody's turned away." And he starts complaining. We see the whole thing. You get a chance to read it, you know, and he's sitting there in that still small voice. "What are you doing here?" And then he says, "Look, you're not the only one left. There's 7,000 more that have not turned their heart to Baal." So God says, "I want you to do some things for me," and he gives them some instructions. So we pick up there. One of the instructions is in 1 Kings 19. Look what it says. "So he departed from there and found Elisha, the son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen before him, and he was with those 12 oxen. And Elijah passed by him and threw his mantle on him." What did he throw on him? He threw his coat, his mantle. Now, what we might not understand is, back then, if you had an office with God, you had a cloak and you had clothing that went with the office. Hello. And so this was a sign, this cloak, this mantle was a sign of the covenant that God wanted to make with Elisha. Now, who searches the hearts? God searches the hearts. So God knew exactly where Elisha was, but Elisha hadn't discovered where he was. Hello. Because his heart was still with mom and dad at home, still according to the commandment to honor your mother and your father. So watch this as we do it. I just want to bring up some very important points to relate to our walks. Okay, so he passed by and threw his mantle on him, and he left the oxen and ran after Elijah and said, "Please let me kiss my father and my mother, and I will follow you." And he said to them, "Go back, for what have I done to you?" You see, a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways, or a double-minded woman. Why? Because we're between two lives. We have a physical life, and we have a spiritual life. And whatever life controls us is whose life we serve. Amen? Hello? So, I did a one-time teaching, don't feed the beast. Get it if you get a chance. The beast is your flesh. Don't overfeed the beast. But anyway, so he was caught between his parents. What should I do? Tell my parents, go back. And here Elijah says, what have I done to you? I put you in a double-minded state. But you know what? God is calling us. God has a purpose and a plan for us. He wants us to understand that the things he has for us does not exclude anything else but the sin and the hurt and the fallen nature of the enemy, but it includes your family. Did you ever read through the scripture? How often? Even Rahab. He not only promised to be a covenant protector, but he to protect their family. Did you know in Israel today, the only place over there in the walls of Jericho, see, God did not knock the walls over like you may have been told. He shoved the walls right down into the ground so you could walk over them. Why would you say that, Pastor? They were 40 feet thick. If they just fell over, you still had 40 feet to climb. He pushed them right on into the earth. Hello. But the only place that he didn't push in and destroy was where Rahab and her family lived. And to this day, the ruins, that's the only thing that's left of Jericho. The rest you just walk on. Isn't it amazing how God leaves a memorial for those that are faithful to him? Say, that's me. Are you faithful to him? Yes, I am. Now, the enemy would probably convince you otherwise, but you just smile and say, I belong to God. Shut up. Amen. That's how you talk to the enemy. And that's all you say. And then you move on. Don't get in a conversation with what the devil's telling you. And then certainly don't repeat it to some brother or sister. Can you say amen? So, and he said to him, go back. What have I done to you? And so Elijah turned back from him and took a yoke, the yoke of oxen, and slaughtered them and boiled their flesh. I don't know about you, but I love cooked flesh. I don't like boiled meat. But anyway, he boiled the flesh using the oxen's equipment and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he arose and followed Elijah and became his servant. You know, many of us follow the Lord, but are we his servant? That's a good question. Then he goes on. A couple of things I'm going to bring up. Three things to notice. God chose Elijah, placing his mantle on him. Elisha had to settle things in his heart so that he could follow God. And thirdly, Elisha came and became a servant of Elijah. In other words, he stuck to him. The guy could probably hardly ever go even to the bathroom without Elisha following him. Hello. Like today we have restrooms and doors shut, you know. Back then it was finding a rock or something. Not that I want to be. So this guy was like, I'm not leaving you. I want everything. I want to know everything you're about. I want to follow you. I want to see what you do. Kind of like Jesus' disciples, huh? Amen? Listen, today, if you want to move in the power of God like God promised, you're going to have to stick to Jesus like glue and really pay attention to what he's telling you. It's quiet in here. Let's move on. Now, let's drop on down a little farther. It's interesting. Note, Elisha would not leave Elijah's side. Could you imagine what that was like? And would not separate himself from him. These places where Elijah followed Elijah, each time refusing to leave Elijah's side, he gives us a list. Now, these names are interesting. Let me give them to him. First of all, they started off on this journey from a place called Gilgal. Everyone say Gilgal. Now, if you've been to school or you know a little bit about Gilgal, Gilgal is what God had Joshua do on the other side of the Jordan. They were to put 12 stones as a reminder of God's covenant to the Israelites. And they made a place of remembrance called Gilgal. No, not Gilgatha. That's where Jesus was crucified. It was called a place of remembrance. And every time that they passed by that area, they looked at the stones, the monuments, and they reminded them of the covenant that God had made with them. So here is the story. They left from Gilgal, the place of God's remembrance of an old covenant. Where's the next place? Bethel. They went to Bethel. Now, we could be reading this for quite some time, so I'm just going to tell you. Bethel means house of God. They left the remembrance of the old covenant, and they moved by the Spirit to the house of God. And here's Elisha going, I'm not leaving you. And you know, we see that Elijah says, well, look, you wait here. I'm going to go to Bethel, you know. And oh, and he says, as the Lord lives, I'm not leaving you. Okay, so Bethel means house of God. Not only that, but then they went from Bethel to a place called Jericho. We shared with that easier. Jericho. Now, Gilgal is a circle, never-ending place of remembrance. Bethel is the house of God, and Jericho is a place of fragrance. What I believe God was doing with Elijah as he was following Elijah, preparing his heart and making effort to show in his heart little reminders of how God's grace is unfolding before Elijah. Now remember, Elijah, Elisha, okay? Amen. So from Jericho, the place of fragrance, they came to the Jordan. We know that the Jordan is the place where Elisha sees Elijah being caught up, okay? And this is what we want to see about the mantle. So in Jordan, the word Jordan, say, I'd like to know what the word Jordan means. It means the descending of the Lord, or the descending place. So he went from place of remembrance to the house of God, to the place of fragrance, so God could descend to take up Elijah as the old and replace them with Elisha, the new. So say, I got that. I'm right there with it. Amen. Cool. And we'll find that in 2 Kings chapter 2, 6 through 14, but we won't go there because of time. I pretty much shared the whole story. The key points I want to give you is Elisha was a great servant. How about us? Are we a great servant, a great child of God? Now, it's one thing. There's a difference between being a child of God, which you are, and a servant of God. Now, I have two kids on my side of my marriage, okay? It was so wonderful to see God raise them up. But after they reach the age of accountability and they mature, they have to make their own choices about God. You might be here today. In fact, there's somebody here today that's concerned about one of their children. And I want to say, don't be concerned. You just get on fire for the Lord, and God will deal with them and work with them. You keep praying. Keep thanking the Lord. God doesn't leave the family out. Amen? Now, I don't know who that is. When God gives me something and a pressure on my spirit to flow out, I don't know. And I'd rather not him tell me. Can you say amen? Because I can muddle things up. Amen. So, Elisha was a great servant and student. He understood being humble and how to be attentive. The other point I want to give you is Elijah's mantle. The Hebrew word for mantle is the Hebrew word adret. And I don't know if I'm pronouncing it quite right, but I've never been a Hebrew scholar, never attempt to be. Amen. One day, one guy was saying to me, he says, you know, I want to learn Hebrew. And I said, why do you want to learn Hebrew? He says, so I can talk to God in his own language. We get crazy sometimes. I looked at him, I says, well, when you asked the Lord to forgive you of your sins, what language did you use? Well, I learned Hebrew. I says, he doesn't problem with any of the languages because he made them all. Yeah, you see what I mean? How we get in these little religious things kind of makes us feel good. I learned a little Hebrew. Not much, but amen. So I want to, if you want to learn Hebrew, it's wonderful. It's a beautiful language. Almost lost it. It was revived in the 40s, 1940s, and had almost, the devil almost destroyed it. But the word adret means cloak, garment, a robe of righteousness. This mantle signified a covenant and the office of a prophet. Say amen. Now let me ask you something. Jesus is the Savior of the world, is he not? He's the Son of the living God. Was he not also a prophet? Yes. He was a prophet, priest, and king to the fullness. You fulfilled all of the Old Testament. Everything, all the things in the, this is the exciting, everything in the Old Testament, including the story, the fact historical stories, the implements of the temple, even the temple itself, are all a type and shadow of Christ and Christ in us. You see? But the temple, three compartments, outer court, inner court, and most holy place. Outer court, inner court, most holy place. You see, Jesus, outer court, inner court, most holy place. So in the Old Testament, don't get caught up in just the stories themselves. Get up caught in the Christ of the story and let him minister to you in the here and now. Can you say amen? I love the Old Testament. I love to read it. The book of Joshua is one of my favorites. I just love to see what God did to him. I like the part when he's coming, he's walking up ready to go into battle and the angel of the Lord stands before him. And he suddenly falls down on his face and he says, Joshua, he says, are you for us? Are you against us? Right away, he recognized that he, you know, this thing was better be before. And you know, when you read in the Old Testament, maybe you didn't know this, when you see the term in the Old Testament, the angel of the Lord, and you see people bowing before the angel of the Lord, it's not just any angel, it is the Lord himself. Because we read in Revelations that when people bowed before the angel or the messenger said, well, get up, I'm a man just like you. But in this case, Joshua wasn't told to get up. Why? Because he was facing the Lord. And he says, are you with us or against us? And he did, you know, and you know, the interesting thing, this blows your mind. He says, neither. Did you know that? He said, neither. Why? Because I am for those who believe in me. The devil can't believe in him. Well, can believe in him, but he doesn't follow him. Are you with me? So I just thought I'd throw that in for a little nugget here. As we see this, this is really exciting. So Elijah's mantle, Hebrew, adret, cloak, garment, robe. This mantle signifies the covenant, a robe of authority and power. So it is the robe of one who holds the office and the calling. They get a robe for that office and that calling, such as a robe of righteousness. Put on a garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Right? All right. So we're going to catch it. You're going to understand here in a minute why the mantle of the Lord is so important to you, and may it make you hungry to search the scripture for more. What did Elisha request when he came to the place that Elijah, well, here the story goes on in 2 Kings. He says, if you see me when I am caught up into the whirlwinds, ask what you want, Elisha. So they get to the Jordan, the angel God starts to come down in a fiery chariot, and suddenly he sees it, you know, and gets caught up. And Elisha says, where is the Lord God? What do you want? And he says, I want twice as much as you got. And you can study Elisha's life. He literally did twice as many miracles as Elijah, his predecessor. So as he was taken up, he says, if you see me when I'm taken up, just ask what you will, and it'll be granted to you. And so he says, a double portion. He says, this is a hard thing, but nevertheless. So as he's being taken up, what does he do? He throws his mantle down to Elijah. And Elisha picked it up, and he tore off his clothes, symbolically, that it's time you and I get rid of our own selfish clothing, the things that array us by our social behaviors, and pick up the clothing God wants us to wear. Amen? Well, the clothing that God wants us to wear, his name is Jesus Christ. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for your flesh. Romans chapter 13, right around verse 11. And so naturally, he cast down his mantle, and Elisha tore off his clothes. Then he picked up the mantle. Everyone say, pick up the mantle. Because this is very key. To your walk with the Lord, you must pick up the mantle. It's an act of your will, so I want to catch you on that, and we'll try to just bless you with the understanding of this. And so he tears off his clothes, he picks up the mantle, rolls it up, and he says, "Where is the Lord God of Elijah?" And he strikes the waters of Jordan, and they part. Ooh, glory to God, right? Why? Because of the symbol of the covenant and the cloaking of the Lord. Are you with me? That coat's been used a lot. Well, let's catch this. Go with me to Luke now. Let's go to Luke 24. You and I are to be like Elisha. Walk and stay close to Christ. His disciples, I would say that they were pretty close to that. And God always repeats himself. Somebody said, "Well, Pastor, how come God always repeats himself?" Because he knows it takes a while for us to get it. Can you say amen? And God doesn't change, does he? It's like a lot of people look at me, and I don't know where you sit on this, but I believe in a rapture. I really do. I believe it's scriptural. I don't care what people said. Somebody from 18-something or other got a revelation from God and suddenly picked out the rapture scriptures. No, I found out my Bible taught it at the very beginning. And you know why? Because God is consistent. Let me ask you, what does rapture mean? It means to be caught up, right? Who was the first person caught up? Enoch. Said he walked with God and he pleased God. So God took him. He did not see death. All right? The second person is the guy we're talking about. So that's a form of a rapture, isn't it? Elijah, the prophet, just before he threw down his mantle, was caught up in a fiery chariot and did not see death. And yet my Bible says, it's appointed unto man to die once and then the judgment. There's two guys that never tasted death yet. They have to still die. Boy, what are those two for? The two witnesses in the book of Revelation. It's not Moses, because the devil disputed over Moses' body. If he had a body in the ground somewhere, then he died. But Enoch didn't die, and neither did Elijah die. No, they're preserved, ready to be the two witnesses that's going to deal some heavy blows to the Antichrist and his group. Thank God, if you believe the way I do, you won't be there. You get to view from heaven. I don't know about you, but I don't want anything chasing me around that looks like something that's going to sting me and I can't die. You know, golly, I don't want to slip back under the old covenant for 7 years in the tribulation. That's what it is, Daniel's 70th week, where we don't have the graces as we do in the New Testament. No, I want God to take me up just like he did his son. Are you with me? So you and Luke, go ahead and let's read this. Look, here's Jesus appearing to his disciples in verse 46 through 49. Jesus is appearing to his disciples. Now, he already kind of berated them. He already told them, hey, you guys got to fix this unbelief that you have. Then he said in verse 46, then he said to them, "Thus it is written, and thus it is necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day." Why is it necessary? Do you know why? You can't be saved unless Jesus rose again from the dead. He's the first fruits. He's the resurrection and the life. Amen? And because he's the first fruits, that means there's a second fruit, third fruit, millions of fruit. Can you say amen? Hi, fruit. Amen. So he says, and that repentance, change of heart, change of mind, and remission of sins, renunciation of sins, should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. Now look at this next phrase. And you are witnesses of these things. Behold, I sent the promise of my Father upon you, but wait in the city of Jerusalem. We have the word tarry. But tarry or wait in the city of Jerusalem until you be endowed with power from on high. Jesus rose again from the dead 50 days after his resurrection. The day of Pentecost came. Now, funny thing, you might not know this, check it out for yourself, but Jesus went up to heaven, came right back down, and for 10 days before Pentecost, he witnessed to over 500 witnesses, told them of his resurrection. First, he had to go have his blood purified and everything like that. That's why he said to Mary, "So Mary, let go of me. I must go to my father." She wasn't keeping him from the father, but she was tugging on his heart, and he needed to take care of business. So he went up, took care of business, came on back down, and for 10 days, he appeared. People on the road, in there doubting Thomas, walked through the wall, says, "Here am I, glory to God." Thomas says, "Oh, my Lord, my Savior." You see what I'm saying? But the beauty part of this is God threw down his mantle. Will you pick it up? So after those 10 days, 40 days more, then Pentecost had fully come. But he said, go to Jerusalem and wait for that time. What was happening? God's blood was being analyzed. God is rathering his reinforcements. The devil was being bound. All this was happening. And then 40 days after Jesus finally left, we're going to see the account of it, finally left, raptured, by the way, caught up to his Father, God dropped in the Holy Spirit. Now, who can remember? Acts chapter 2, it says, and then when Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Now, I'm going to go to this place here in just a minute, but I'm just going to kind of get you understand that God was about to do something that had never been done in the earth since the creation of Adam and Eve. He was going to, because of his legal death and resurrection, and because he broke Satan's neck and power, just like it was prophesied in Genesis 3:15. Suddenly, God was now going to come into the earth by permission. Unlike ever before, in the Old Testament, God was limited because of men's hearts, because they love sin more than they love God. Hello? And so he had to go by invitation in the Old Testament. People like Abraham had to make a covenant, Jacob, Isaac. They had to talk to God and invite God. Abraham stood on a hill in Ur of the Chaldees and said, oh gosh, there's got to be more than these sticks and stones and these moons. He was the first moony. They worshiped the moon and the sun. All they didn't even know what they worshiped. And Abraham broke loose and he says, there's got to be something more, because God put in our hearts, every human being out there, a need for God. They just try to put it with alcohol and try to fill that, everything else they can fill. But we only run on God. That's why all that other stuff fails and breaks and it causes embarrassment and all that kind of stuff. And so suddenly, the Holy Spirit come into the earth like never before. Like never before. Why? Because the curtain had been broken, the separation had been wiped out, and now the Spirit of God came into every mall. Listen to me. Carefully, you search this out. Every molecule of the air you and I now breathe has God in it. That's why we hear songs here recently in the last couple, 10, 15 years. You are the air I breathe. The difference is now that we have Jesus, there's a separator in our spirit that is able to pull God into our hearts. At any given time, it's like the witness of water on a sponge. Anytime that you want, you could pull the presence of God in on you. This, the enemy doesn't want you to know this, folks. Jesus went through all a hell and back so he could drop his mantle into the earth via the Holy Spirit mantle so that you and I can pick it up and go with it. Well, let's look what the scripture says here. I just love this. So he says, go wait in Jerusalem until you be endowed. The word endowed there is an interesting word because it includes, listen to me, it includes the word zapped. Go to Jerusalem and let God zap you with his spirit and change your nature and change your clothing and change your outlook. Endowed, clothed or cloaked. And it includes in that language, it's kind of a transliteration. It includes in that language the ability to zap you with God. I mean, maybe you don't like those terms and everything. To me, it makes a lot of sense. Nobody's going to shoot me with a negative sin gun. I got shot with God gun. And the more I go with him, the more I open up to him, the more God endows me. So guess what? The limit is in us. So that's why the enemy tries to get you so distracted all the time. You're so busy, can't come to church, you can't do this, because here you're going to be trained and explained who you really are. Another church like it anyway. You say, well, Pastor Curry, I kind of know that. Knowing it and doing it. Amen. Notice the promise is set upon them. Okay, now let's go to Acts chapter 1, verse 4. Acts 1, verse 4. And being assembled together with them, this is talking about the Lord, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father. We read that in Luke 24, too. Which he said, you have heard from me, for John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now, 40 days. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, and they said, Lord, look at this. This is a message for us at this time. Lord, would you at this time restore the kingdom of God to Israel? Curious. But look at how Jesus answered this. And I want to give you the message of God just keeps bringing things to me. And he said to them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons. And yet we have churches, that's all they're doing, is finding out the feasts, the times, and the seasons, and they're trying to get some kind of grace from it. You cannot get grace from the Old Testament. You can get grace from Jesus Christ, and he can bring that grace out of the Old Testament when you focus on him. But by doing ceremonies just like the Levite and just like the high priest, it cannot save us nor transform us. It's not for us to know the times or the seasons, which the Father has kept in his own power. I'm going to stop there because the message, there's a deception going on, and I'm not anti-Jewish or anti-anything, but you cannot make a Gentile be a Jew. It's forbidden. God made Jews Jews. You are a Jewish in nature when you accept Christ. You're circumcised in heart, not flesh. For us to be circumcised in heart, to start off in the realm of the Spirit, and then leave the realm of the Spirit to think we could get better by not doing, by doing, by practicing and not practicing. We're doing all this stuff. That's right. We're doing it. We've got to be careful. So I love the Old Testament. I love the feasts. I have a whole series on all the feasts. I love the graces about all that, but just remember, we can't practice something that was never originally gave to us. It was for the Jews. And the Ten Commandments, I'm just talking about the Ten Commandments, because the Torah is good, all of these things are good, but the Ten Commandments were given to Jews for one reason, to show them they can't save themselves. Why would we leave the grace of God to go find out that we can't save ourselves? I mean, is that just simple understanding? I can't save myself. I surrendered to Jesus. So the idea is the enemy likes to use deception. He wants to keep your old clothing on, you know, and maybe if you're lucky, you'll be at a meeting and somebody will touch you with a blessing, you know. And again, I'm not putting any of this down, but what are we believing in? Is that what God wants us to do? Well, anyway, not really, but catch this. This is good. He baptized with water. Therefore, when they came together and asked him, he says, look, it's not for you to know the times and seasons which the Father has put in his own authority, but you shall receive what? Receive power. A Greek word is dunamis or dunamis, and it means the inherent ability to produce Jesus on the spot. Shows instant access again. You and I have been given instant access. We can take up the mantle. We don't have to stand around and go, I don't know what God's doing in my life. Well, of course not. If I knew everything God was doing in my life, I'd certainly get in the way of my accident. trying to help him out. Come on now. Instead, I want to trust him and let him work it out of me and give it to me. I always say this to God. God, you know, I'm a human, and I know you know that. But Lord, I'm pretty hard to understand what you want sometimes, so you're going to have to make it clear to me. Yeah, I'd rather have it clear. Don't do this. Then be going, what do you want done for me today, God? No, don't do this. Catch me. So he says, look, when the Spirit of God, the power of God has come upon you, you'll be a witness to me in Jerusalem and Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. Now, when he had spoken these things, and while they watched, he was taken up. He was raptured. And a cloud received him out of their sight. Jesus rose from the dead, showed himself before many witnesses, ascended up into heaven, and cast down his mantle, the Holy Spirit. Now, it's very important you and I catch this. So let's go over to Acts chapter 2. I quoted part of it, and we'll finish up with this. The mantle has been fallen nearly 2,000 years, but it was when you and I decided that we needed God. We're tired of ourselves. I had to come to the end of myself, frankly. I had to come to the end of myself because the drugs weren't doing it. The alcohol wasn't doing it. The women weren't doing it. I had a lot of wonderful lady friends. And yet, there was something so empty in me. Then I got saved. It just seemed like, wow, this is exciting. The only way I could relate it, Heidi, was, man, this is the best stone I ever been on, man. You know what I'm saying? That's how I didn't have anything to relate. I wasn't born in any kind of church or anything. So all I could relate it to is that blissful peace of mind that you try to get with drugs, and you can never get it with the drugs. But God all of a sudden zaps you with the best thing in the world, and you're going, man alive. I love what my cousin said to me. He led me to my pastor, Pastor Sires, and he was just praying, God save Gary, he really needs it. God save Gary, he's really awful, and he really needs to be saved. And so I get saved. So you know what he says to me? This is maybe somebody said this to you. He says, boy, you really got saved, didn't you? Yeah, he did. I said, yeah, I really did. But he was thinking, well, I didn't get saved like that. Maybe I'm not saved. You see how funny we are. And he says, yeah, I really got saved. Now you don't have to worry about me being a thorn in your flesh, brother. You know, and then God began to take me on this wonderful walk. And you know, when he's taken us all on this wonderful walk, always be personal with him. Open your heart up. Be able to take his mantle. You didn't deserve the mantle, but take the mantle. It's for his witness and his testimony in the earth. Amen. And that goes back to what I've taught you. So when you realize and you take up the mantle in the anointing, and we'll finish up with it, you disappear. You literally disappear to the devil. The devil cannot see you. And this is where a lot of people don't realize. You can't see you. Now, when you get out and start acting up and doing your own thing, the enemy knows it's you. But when you say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I take up that mantle. You want me to go over to Seattle and pray for some sick people? I take up that mantle, Lord, and I ask you to place that down upon me. Ooh. I can tell you testimony after testimony of doing that. My pastor taught me that, and he taught me that by a coat. He says, son, when you accept Jesus Christ, your old clothes are removed. And God has placed on you a robe of righteousness. He's placed on you his mantle. And now you're to shine for Jesus. And you're going to make plenty of mistakes. But you just keep going. Watch what God will do. And man, I tell you what, I got so many times. We need to have just a testifying meeting. Times that I went down into the mission field, thousands of people got saved by accident. You know, you can have a lot of faith accidents in a third world country where everybody believes for God because they don't have anything else. Amen. So, Acts chapter 2, verse 1 says, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all in one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven. Remember this, God filling the earth like never before, from heaven, of a rushing mighty wind. And it filled the whole house where they were sitting. It kind of throws it all out. Well, somebody said to me, God doesn't dwell in houses made with hands. Bet me, he's in my living room all the time. Hello? And then he's in this house. This is just a house for the body of Christ. Just a place to keep us out of the rain. Can you say amen? But he fills this house too. Amen. And it filled all the house where they were sitting. There appeared unto them divided tongues as of fire. One sat on each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now, I am a tongue-talking, wonderful Christian. I came out of the charismatic movement and the word movement, where Catholics and Episcopalians and everybody were getting saved and filled with the Spirit. Remember those days? It wasn't so long ago. Those days are coming back because the church is going to stop being distracted and get it focused. Can you say amen? It's coming back, folks. It's coming back. And maybe God will start with you just getting out there and just sharing the things of God. So let me ask you, is there a difference between infilling and clothing? Yes, there is. You see, the Bible wants, or the Bible says, and God wants us filled with the Spirit. Being filled with the Spirit, God transforms and washes you and cleanses you and everything. But what we often forget is the Holy Spirit came upon them. And when you guys are praying and you're saying, God, and you just sense in your heart that God wants you to do something for him, there's a cloaking, there's a mantle that comes on you for that specific job. Hello? And you've got to learn to pick it up and let it drop on you. See, I found out that if I let God's Spirit come down on me as well as rise up on the inside of me, it isn't anything that I'm going to do that's going to impress anybody. It's my ability to yield to what is needed to be done. That's what that cloaking is for. So God wants you filled all the time, every day in the Spirit. But there'll be certain times where all of a sudden you'll sense something come down on you a little heavier. Go, what is that? Well, we know it to be the Spirit of God. But now you know it to be God's mantle coming down on top of you to cover you, to promote you, and so the enemy will back off of you. Again, I tell everybody, and we'll finish up with this thought, the devil's not afraid of you. He's afraid of God in you. Turn him loose. Turn him loose. Amen. Turn him loose. How do you go about doing that? Well, hang around for next week. We're going to show you how to move in the anointing and flow with the anointing. But I do it in such a way we can't forget. Remember when these kind of teachings started coming out, everybody took the gun that had the bullets and got all friendly with the gun, forgot the giver of the gun. The church got caught up so much in what God was doing in this supernatural and all the different things that were happening all over the place. They lost their focus on the captain of their salvation and got into the gifts themselves. Now, one of my majors for Bible college is the gifts of the Spirit. Very, very well trained in him. What's good, what's not good, what's flesh, what's not flesh. God wants us to know how to utilize those things. So Jesus threw down his mantle. You need to pick it up. How are we doing on tearing off our old self and putting on the new man? Pretty good? I don't know. I don't want to answer at this point. I don't want to ask. Yes, you're doing just great at it. The idea is now you understand what you're picking up. You're picking up God's mantle that he purposed and planned for you at the beginning of the age. You're picking it up and you're saying, God, I'm going to wear your clothing because it's not my own clothing that's going to scare the enemy. It's not my own clothing that's going to promote the Lord. It's not my own clothing and my own adequacy that's going to cause change in my family. It's me picking up your mantle and letting your Spirit do the work. Hallelujah. So Elisha picked up Elijah's mantle, rolled it up and says, and struck the water, where is the Lord God of this mantle of Elijah? Well, folks, He is with you. He is in you. Four revelations that I want to give you. Did you know more than half the church still thinks God's against them? Yet the Bible says, if God be for you, who can be against you? Did you know that the Bible tells us that during Christmas time, we use it, Emmanuel, Emmanuel, which is God with us. So first revelation is number one, God is for you, not against you. Number two, God is with us. Wherever we go, there he is. Number three, God is in us. The hope of glory. God is in us. Woo-hoo-hoo. Let him out once in a while. Stop covering for him. But the biggest part where the cloaking and the anointing of the mantle comes down is we're in God. What do you mean? When you learn by the Spirit to slow down a little bit and move from the realm of the Spirit, it isn't your hand going out and touching someone. It's God's hand going out and touching them because you're moving right with the Spirit. So you don't have to believe for somebody to get healed. You just need to tell them to believe and healing will flow. We got one day Christianity. One day when God gets ready, he's going to be healing us. He's going to be helping us. One day. Now is the time. Today is the day. Pick up the mantle. Well, if you got something out of that, would you give the Lord a hand clap?